श्री सौम्यकाशेश महेश्वराय तस्मै नमः स्वामि तपोवनाय तस्मै नमः स्वामि तपोवनाय हरि ओम सल्यूटेशंस टू ऑल ऑफ यू इन द गीता इन द 10th चैप्टर When Bhagwan describes his vibhutis, he says, Sthavaranam Himalayah, amongst those which are non-movable things, I am the Himalaya. Srotasam Asmi Janhavi, among the rivers, I am the Ganga. Adhyatma Vidya, Vidyanam, amongst the all knowledges, I am spiritual knowledge. And if Lord Krishna had to speak in today's context, he would have said, Sanyasinam Swami Tapovanam. And amongst the sannyasis, I am Swami Tapovanam. So we are here in the sacred place of Uttarkashi, the abode of Swami Tapovanji Maharaj. He was Brahman, as we just see in the Tapovan Shatkam. Where he is extolled as Brahman himself and as Ishwara Samyakashisha. So as Brahman is indescribable. But the form that he took and the way he lived his life is a very epitome of sannyas and tapas. So today we will just reflect on a few incidents of his life. And try to derive inspiration from it and lift our minds. Gurudev once told a brahmachari in Mumbai, in Sandipani when he was studying, Gurudev told a brahmachari that the very air that you are breathing is the grace of Swami Tapovan Maharaj. And Gurudev always believed that the entire work of Chinmay Mission is nothing but the glory of Tapovanji Maharaj. The expression of the grace of Tapovanji Maharaj. So Guruji also said in the World Workers Conference last year in December in Vibhuti, Guruji also said that the foundation of the Chinmay Mission is the very tapas that Swami Tapovanji Maharaj did. And there is a nice composition that Guruji has written called Tapovan Stuti. 4 verses on the glory of Tapovanji. So in that, the very first verse, Guruji says that, you know, when the Lord takes avatar, there are different qualities which also manifest in this world and they take up an abode. And even in general, you will see many people personifying some qualities. So the divine qualities, some people, Harishchandra personified truth, Mahatma Gandhi personified ahimsa, Vivekananda patriotism, fearlessness. The demonic qualities, dambha, mana, abhimana, all these, the rakshasas and many egoistic people would personify. So in that verse he says that sannyas was looking for an abode to reside and it could not find a befitting abode. So sannyas approached the Lord and said that I don't have a befitting abode. Where do I reside? So he said that Bhagwan gives place to everybody. He said Nidra Devi also has an abode. And what is the abode of Nidra Devi? Satsang. Nidra Devi, abode of Nidra Devi is in satsang. Happily people sleep. So that way, you know, the abode, everyone approaches Bhagwan. So Bhagwan was compassionate and he said, he looked around the whole world and he said, in this land of Kerala, this young person who is here, he is fit for all the requirements that you need as an abode of sannyas. He is a fit person. And not only you go and stay there, in that verse Guruji says, go and stay in that person and worship him. Because he is the one who lends glory even to sannyas. Right from his birth onwards he was absolutely detached. And in fact he took sannyas, his qualities of dispassion and detachment were so high that the first sannyas that he took sannyas by himself. From childhood, many years he dreamed about sannyas, living like an ascetic. And he cultivated all those qualities within him. And he said that the first sannyas that he took, he was studying under Swami Hridayanandaji. And he studied Mandukya and many Upanishads under him. So Swami Hridayanandaji told him that you don't need to be given sannyas by anybody. You are fit to take sannyas by yourself. And he thought about that. He also thought about his own teacher, Swami Santyananda Saraswati, under whom he learnt, who told him that you are fit to take sannyas. And he thought about it. And after 34 years on the banks of Gangaji, on the banks of Narmada river, he took sannyas by himself. He did the rites and rituals which are prescribed, and then he took sannyas by himself. And the name that he took for himself was Swami Tyagananda. Such an appropriate name. And he thought about it, that people like Buddha, Vivekananji, Ram Tirtha, all of them have taken sannyas by themselves. So he thought about it, that am I really fit? And he found that yes, I am. And then he took by himself, he took sannyas. And the heights which he established as a sannyasi, the role model, what a sannyasi should be. That's why Guruji writes in that verse that sannyas not only found an abode in Swami Taponji Maharaj, but also sannyas worshipped him. So his life itself is an embodiment of tyag, of tapas, of sannyas. So today we will see two aspects of his life. One is tapas and one is sannyas. Even in the Keno Upanishad we just saw in the morning, the virtues which are mentioned there, tapas, dama, karma, satyam. Taponji Maharaj is the embodiment of all these. So in the Gita it is said three types of tapas are there. Body, physical tapas, mental tapas and vak tapas. So we see how Taponji Maharaj lived according to that. So the 17th chapter Bhagavan says, Deva Dviju Guru Prajna Pujanam Shaucha Marjavam Brahmacharya Mahimsacha Shariram Tapa Uchyate. Taponji Maharaj was one such great master that if there is something written in the Shastra, you will see that manifesting in his life, especially the Upanishads and the Gita. So first thing written there is Deva Dvija Guru Prajna Pujanam, worship of the Lord Deva. And we find in Taponji Maharaj's life, right from his childhood, he was not only a worshipper of Lord Shiva, but very deeply devoted to the very concept of Ishvara, to the Lord himself. And so from childhood, if you see the Ishvara Darshan, which is his autobiography, he visited so many temples. He never missed an opportunity to visit the temples. Almost all the temples of South India he visited. Kumbakonam and Chidambaram and Kanyakumari and Kanchi and Sri Rangam, every temple. And he would visit the temple, do the worship, stay there, meet the Mahatmas, have satsang. At any given opportunity, he would slip away to go to a temple, to take up a pilgrimage. In fact, the first part of his Ishvara Darshan, the first half of the Ishvara Darshan is only him visiting so many temples. So Deva Pujanam. And every day he used to do the worship of Lord Shivji. Even after his realization, every day he kept going to Saumyakashi temple, carry the water from Gangaji, go there, do the Abhishek. And it is said that he composed Every day he would compose one verse of one verse on Samyak Ashish. And he would go in front of the Lord. After doing the Abhishek, he would sing that entire verse. So there is a whole book, Samyak Ashish Stotram, that he wrote. So Deva Pujanam. Dvija is a wise person or a Brahmana. Prajna is a wise person. And in his life we find that formally he did not study step by step by step under one teacher, but so many Mahatmas he had satsang of. Deva, Dvija and Guru. He had two main Gurus. One was Swami Hridayananji and one was Swami Santyananji. And he studied from them. So Deva, Dvija, Guru, Prajna, Pujanam. Shaucham. Cleanliness. Very, one is at the physical level of course, cleanliness. Every day it is said that he would get up at 3 o'clock, go for a long walk. When he used to stay in Gangotri and Uttarkashi, etc., he would go for a long walk at 3 o'clock, go into the forest, do his pranayama, etc., and then take his bath and come back by 5, 6. Even as a householder when he lived, he did that. Every morning waking up at 3 o'clock, did all his duties till 8 o'clock. And it is said that he would be lost in the state of Samadhi for such a long time. But he had to come back to take care of the worldly duties, so then he would come back. So one is physical purity. Second is mental purity. His mind was so pure. We will see that when we come to that qualities of the mind. But one incident in his life was so striking that he never allowed the thoughts of worldliness to come into his mind. Many people even tried to persuade him to marry, but he never entertained even a single thought about that. His mind was kept so pure, only focused on the thoughts of the Lord. So one day when he was traveling to Baroda to meet his guru, to spend some time and learn from him, it is said that on the way in the train there was a couple who were sitting there and they were having a nice loving conversation. And looking at them for a moment, the thought passed his mind that how loving this couple are and how joyously they are living. Just that much thought came. And when he reached his guru said to him that your mind got polluted. And Taponji Maharaj, it is said that he also felt that why did I even entertain that thought? I mean, imagine his standards of purity, that not even a thought of worldliness he would allow in his mind. He did not even think that how nice it would be if I lived like that. He just thought that how nice is their worldly life. That is all. So Shaucham, is that the purity, the standards of purity that he had are very, very high. There are no thought of worldliness at all. Absolutely. Arjavam, very straightforward and simple. In fact, Gurudev used to define, if you have to explain about Taponji Maharaj, he would say that simple living and high thinking. That is the life of Taponji Maharaj. He was actually born in a Kshatriya family and his father was very wealthy. His mother had died when he was young and father also passed away very soon. And all the wealth, property, everything came to him. He was the eldest son. But he never took anything for himself. Even at that time he had only one pair of clothes with him. And he lived in his life as a trustee, that the Lord has given this to me as a duty, so I continue to perform my duty. He actually had intense desire for sannyas and he was about to leave and his father passed away. And for 8 years he lived in his house performing the duty because his younger brother had not finished his education. So for 8 years he continued to live doing his duties maintaining the family, but for not a moment he identified with the wealth or with his stage in life there as a householder. So he lived in such a simple way. Gurudev writes in one place that even after he took sannyas, he had only 3 pairs of clothes with him, and he would not allow one extra pair of clothes. Even if somebody gifted to him, he would give it away to someone else. He would not allow one extra pair of clothes. And Gurudev writes that, you know, once sometimes it would happen that the clothes would be torn many times, because he would wander in the Himalayas and he would wander in many places. So the clothes would be torn and they would be stitched up. And so sometimes it would be the clothes have torn so many times that it is not like a one piece of cloth anymore. It is all patches of clothes. What do you read in Bhajagovindam? Rathya charpata virachita kantha, punya punya vivarjita pantha. Literally like that. So patches of clothes it would be. And then what Gurudev would do sometimes, he had to go down to wash the clothes sometimes. So he would say that, you know, the Gangaji has taken away that piece of cloth and gone. Because otherwise Tapanji Maharaj won't allow a new piece of cloth to come. So he would say that, you know, Mother Ganga conspire, me and Mother Ganga used to conspire. Let that piece of cloth flow away. So it's such an austere and a simple life, very straightforward. Nothing extra with him. Even now you see in the Taponji's kutia, what is there inside? Hardly anything is there. Nothing is there. So Shaucham, Arjavam, Brahmacharyam, he lived like he was a perfect celibate, not even entertaining a thought in his mind. To live Brahmacharya is the greatest tapas, difficult to do, even at the physical level. In fact, Gurudev writes in one place in Self-Unfoldment, he says that in the beginning for a seeker to live Brahmacharya at the physical level itself is a great strain, and mental level it is very difficult, almost impossible. But Taponji Maharaj lived that way. And many people tried to give him many different reasons to get married. So in this Ishwar Darshan, he himself writes here that beautiful girls too tried to charm the handsome young man and captivate him. But their fond assault on the citadel of his mind, fortified with discriminating thoughts and fixed on devout worship of the Lord, failed miserably. He triumphed over all temptation. And his own friends who were studying with him many times used to give him explanations from the Shastra. So he would say, think about Bhartruhari's verse. You know, this person who was studying with him, Kavya Vachaspati Shri Dayashankar, they had studied together with Swami Santyananji. And there he writes to Taponji Maharaj that think of the words about Bhartruhari, about how he explains about enjoyment and worldly life, and you are such a young person. He says, why shun the highest pleasure man can enjoy in his life? Youth, you know, is like running water. It flows away never to return. Yet, alas, you yield to procrastination. How unreasonable. Why delay? In your part of the country, are there not eligible girls, good and beautiful? And all this he would write. And some of them would tell him even about the duty, that, you know, it is your duty, get married, your lineage has to be continued. And Taponji Maharaj writes here that in midst of all such temptations, he remained immovable as a mountain and majestic like the sea. So he lived his whole life an expression of, and very literally he was embodiment of the word Brahmacharya. Brahmani charati iti Brahmachari. His mind always reveled in Brahman. When somebody forced him a lot, some of his relatives, he said, yes, I will marry. And you will see whom I marry. And when you see that, you will no more regret. And he was married to the Lord and he was wedded to the life of asceticism. सच अ ग्रेट मास्टर ब्रह्मचर्य अहिंसा च नॉन वायलेंस. गुरुदेव सेज अहिंसा इज द क्वालिटी ऑफ द माइंड. फिजिकली एब्सोल्यूट अहिंसा इज नॉट पॉसिबल बट वन कैन लिव विद मिनिमम हिंसा बट मेंटली इट इज पॉसिबल दैट डोंट हर्ट एनीबडी. सो एक्चुअली ही वॉन्टेड टू टेक संन्यास इवन वेन हिज फादर वॉज देयर बट ही राइट्स इन ईश्वर दर्शन दैट एज फार एज पॉसिबल संन्यास मस्ट बी टेकन विदाउट हर्टिंग एनीबडी एंड विद द एक्सेप्टेंस ऑफ ऑल फैमिली मेंबर्स. एंड सो ही डिडंट टेक संन्यास वेन हिज फादर वॉज देयर एंड इवन वेन हिज फादर लेफ्ट हिज मॉर्टल कॉइल ही कुड हैव वेरी क्विकली टेकन संन्यास but he didn't take. Very very sensitive. For 34 years he did not take sannyas. He took sannyas at the age of 34 and he lived in the house doing his worldly duties but spending his time in daily sadhana and samadhi. As he writes, from morning 3 a.m. to 8 a.m. he would spend his time in devotion to the Lord and absorption in samadhi. During the day he would work and in the evening he found a solitary place near his house like a forest and oblivious of all the dangers therein he would just go in there and again from evening 6 to almost midnight he would spend in samadhi thinking about the Lord. So he was very very sensitive not to hurt anybody. Brahmacharyam ahimsa cha शारीरम तप उच्चते इज द श्लोक इन द गीता. मेनी आर हिज एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ द फिजिकल तपस दैट तपोंजी महाराज डिड. फेमस एग्जाम्पल इज ऑफ व्हेन ही वॉज वेरी सिक वेरी क्लोज टू द लास्ट फ्यू डेज एंड somebody ऑफर्ड अ पिलो टू हिम. ही डिड नॉट टेक द पिलो. ही सेड द बॉडी वुड बिकम अ स्लेव ऑफ कंफर्ट्स. And on much more persuasion by that person, like some devotee from Ahmedabad it seems. So he took the pillow, rested on it for a short while, and then Gurudev writes that from the next day it was very painful to see that he even stopped taking the support of the wall which earlier he used to take. Such rigorous penance. Guruji said one day that in bitter cold there was a fire which was lit and somebody was taking the warmth of the fire and they called Taponji Maharaj. He said, I will not come because it is sense pleasure. Just imagine the tapas. Warmth in the bitter cold is sense pleasure. What is our definition of sense pleasure? Can we indulge moderately, Swamiji? Many people ask, no? What is wrong if we indulge in moderation? But he established that ideal, no sense pleasure, absolutely. Swami Sundaranandji says, he was his disciple, in the last few days he served him. So one day it is said that Swami Sundaranandji brought some bhiksha and offered it to Taponji Maharaj. And after some time he requested Taponji Maharaj that, can I have 25 paise. So Taponji Maharaj said, why do you want? He said, we have to buy salt. And Taponji Maharaj said, namak khane ke liye sadhu bane ho kya? Have you become a sadhu to eat salt? How he would eat food, it is said that the food would be brought to him, he would put it in a cloth, dip it in the Gangaji and then he would eat. Why? Control over the taste. No liking to the taste at all. So all the masala has to flow out. Such tapas. So shariram tapas. Many times he would not even go to the doctor. Gurudev writes, in the last few years when he became sick and they requested him, why don't you come down to Delhi, why don't you get treated there? So he said, why the people, the doctors in Delhi, Have they found a cure against death? People don't die in Delhi. He would not go down. He said, the Himalayas are so peaceful. I have lived all my life here. Why should I not pass my life, pass out from this body while I am here? So a lot of tapas that Taponji Maharaj did, even at the physical level. Many times what we think that, let us do more of intellectual tapas, that contemplation that we are doing. Why should we do so much of physical tapas? But he lived his whole life that way, never allowing the body to dominate. Kailash Yatra he did, the first time that he did Kailash Yatra was on barefoot, no proper arrangements. And many times he had experiences where he would not even know whether the body will survive. And if you read that Kailash Yatra, it is very touching. He says that now the Lord will take care of the Lord. And he says that the next day when he woke up, when he reached Kailash, one full night he was just out there in the bare snow. He said next day when he woke up, the thought that came to him was that there is some purpose that the Lord wants to fulfill through the body, so it is still surviving. Queen of Nepal told him that I will make all the arrangements, and he said no. And he went barefooted to Kailash. So the tapas that Taponji Maharaj did, even at the physical level, that just shows the amount of mind over matter. So what do we learn from that? That in our life, what is that physical tapas that we do? Because only when tapas is there in life, tamas can be destroyed. If tapas is not there, there will be a lot of tamas in our life. And that tamas is something which is the cause of our sorrow. Ignorance is tamas. It expresses in terms of indulgence, laziness, lethargy, all that. So what is the tapas that we do in our life? We have to constantly ask ourselves. Because if we belong to that parampara where Taponji Maharaj is our param guru, and the way in which he lived, what tapas? So this is at the physical level. Many times once he came to the Himalayas, he never went down. He only went between, first he was even coming down to Rishikesh, but after some time he stopped even coming to Rishikesh. Only Uttarkashi, Gangotri, and sometimes he used to spend more time in Tapovanam also, which is above Gomukh. The entire, after you cross the Gomukh glacier, there's a whole place called Tapovanam and Nandanvan. So he used to spend time there. So it's about the physical tapas. And he continued to do. A lot of things can be said about the physical tapas that Taponji Maharaj did. It is said that first time, you know, when you take a sannyas, then you are supposed to accept bhiksha from somebody who respects the sadhus and the sannyasis. So when he took his sannyas on the banks of Narmada, there was nobody to give him bhiksha. And it is said that the first bhiksha that he took, he had to go to a place where the poor are fed. And there he went and he asked for the bhiksha, and then he took from there. Many times he was, what do you say, as a sannyasi's glory is not known, many people would rebuke, abuse, even condemn. And that day he would not have any bhiksha and he would be very peaceful. His whole life, if you see, he went through malaria, he went through smallpox, many diseases he went through. For 2 months he suffered from malaria, for 2 full months. But the mind never came down to the body level. One little cold we get and finished. One person has to get cold. Entire camp will give them the medication. Here Taponji Maharaj did not even bother about. He did whatever had to be done at the body level, but did not allow the mind to come down at all. And he said he would sleep also for very few hours. In the intense moments of his sadhana, he would sleep only for 3 to 4 hours. Because he felt that even that sleep is a big obstacle. The mind has to be constantly tuned up to the truth. So that is sharirik tapas. Vak tapas, anudvegakaram vakyam, satyam, priyahitam chayat. Don't speak words which are agitating. There was one small boy, he said, till I was 10 years old, I thought my name was stupid. Because the mother kept on telling me, hey stupid, don't do this, hey stupid, don't do that, hey stupid, sit here. Anudvegakaram vakyam. Let our words not agitate anybody. There was once a group of Brahmins who came to meet Swami Santyananji. And that time Swami Tapovanamji was called as Swami Tyagananji, that he had taken his name as Swami Tyagananda. So he was sitting there, and these Brahmins picked up a debate, and then they became very hostile, and they raised a point saying that how can you, who are not a Brahmin, take up sannyas? You are defying the very tradition of sannyas. And they were very, what do you say, violent in their speech. So Tapovanji Maharaj, he looked at his guru and he said, may I answer? He said, yes, go ahead. And Tapovanji Maharaj said that a mind which is desirous of seeking the truth, which is always wanting to know God, is thinking about God, how can that mind not be called as a Brahmin? Is the Brahmin only by birth? And he explained from the Shastra what are the qualities of a Brahmin. Then they raised the point that you have not even studied the Shastra traditionally. And you have not studied the Shastra traditionally, and then you are setting a wrong example for a sannyasi. And Tapovanji Maharaj very humbly said, yes, I agree, I have not studied the Shastra traditionally. But that is what I am trying to do under Swami Santyananji and all the wise people like you. He never got irritated, never got self-defensive, never got agitated. In fact, it is said that one place, in the second time, when he did Kailash Yatra, the arrangements were made by this Maharaj of Nepal, and there were some Buddhist monks also with Tapovanji Maharaj. He stayed in a Buddhist monastery, and then from there they went to Kailash Yatra. So some of these monks and some of the devotees who were coming along, they had some valuable possessions. So in those days it is said that it was very dangerous to do these kind of yatras, because a lot of robbers and dacoits etc. would come there and they would attack the person, the travelers. So a group of thieves actually spied on these yatris. And they found out that they have a lot of possessions. Some valuable possessions, maybe some money or something they have. So they came back and reported to their leader. And that night, they were going to attack them. One of the thieves stayed back there, where the other people have gone to report. So this thief who stayed back there, he started having a conversation with Tapovanji Maharaj. And Tapovanji Maharaj started explaining to him what is the glory of dispassion and the yatra they are doing and the love of Lord Shiva and all that he started explaining to him. And by the end of that whole conversation, the thief was so transformed, he went back and he reported to the leader that, you know, these are not ordinary people, these are not worldly people, these are great sadhus, mahatmas who are going on a yatra, don't attack them. Very peaceful way. No fear, no anxiety, nothing in his mind. So he would always speak anudvegakaram vakyam, satyam priyahitam chayat, swadhyaya abhyasanam chaiva. He was well versed in the scripture, swadhyaya abhyasanam. What is the abhyasanam there? Bhagavan says he is taking the name of the Lord. And And Tapanji Maharaj writes, if you read his guidance from the Guru, there are letters that he has written to a couple. In that, almost every second or third letter you will find one instruction which comes very frequently is, don't stop taking the name of the Lord. Begin the day by taking the name of the Lord, end the day by taking the name of the Lord. Keep on repeating the name of the Lord. And he did that. Swadhyaya Abhyasanam Chaiva. Gurudev used to say that out of purity and silence come the words of power. And in Tapanji Maharaj's life, you will literally see that. The purity of his life and the silence that he had. From there were born the words of wisdom. So, it is said, he writes about one encounter that he had when he was not even a sannyasi. He was a householder at that time. He was called as, his earlier name was Subramanyam. So once when he was going to many such temples, he came to Tiruvannamalai, went to Arunachaleshwara and did prostration, sang his glory, and then he went to meet Ramana Maharshi. So when he went to meet Ramana Maharshi, he climbed up the hill and he found that Maharshi was in the cave and he was sitting peacefully there. And the devotees used to bring some fruit, so he took some bananas and kept there. And the monkeys came, took the bananas away and went. And Ramana Maharshi was sitting peacefully. He went and sat there in front of Ramana Maharshi. Ramana Maharshi just looked at him. He smiled. And for 1 hour, both of them were sitting quietly. No words exchanged between them. Then Ramana Maharshi got up and he went. It was afternoon time. So Tapanji Maharaj also got up, and as he was going, some devotees there pressed him to have lunch. Tapanji Maharaj says, no, I don't want to have. They were pressing him a little more. So Ramana Maharshi looked back and he said, don't press him. And he went. And Tapanji Maharaj writes there that not a word was exchanged. There was complete silence. Here there was total communion between these two Mahatmas. So he was such a great master. Speech he had complete control on. He would never entertain worldly talk, never. In fact, Gurudev would say that anybody who tried to entertain worldly talk, he would tell them very strictly that don't waste your time, go and contemplate on Brahman. And that's why many disciples would never be able to stay with him. But one incident Gurudev narrates is that, you know, there was one young boy. He was brought by some devotees. The devotees, they were very deep followers of spiritual knowledge, and they had surrendered to Tapanji Maharaj. But their son was actually a rebel. He did not want to follow. So they brought him to Tapanji Maharaj. And that young boy, he came there not in the traditional clothes. He came with all his whatever, jeans and t-shirt and all that. And he came and sat there. And Tapanji Maharaj started inquiring with him about who is the latest hero, what kind of films you like, and what do you do, what are your friends, where do you study, all that. And Gurudev was wondering, my God, why is he talking all this? He could not understand. Very soon he befriended him, and after some time, when the youngster was so comfortable, he just told him, will you just do one thing? As they were going, he said, will you do one thing that I tell you? He said, yes. Every morning, get up early and go for a walk, only for 15 minutes. Sit quietly for 5 minutes. And then come back, and if you want to sleep, sleep. Don't worry. That's all the instruction that he gave him. And Gurudev writes that after 1 year, this boy came back, and it was amazing to see this boy in traditional clothes, having this namam and all that, And he came and prostrated with Taponji Maharaj. He couldn't believe the transformation that happened just in that one meeting. So that is the power of the speech and the tapas that touched his heart. Because he would not otherwise entertain worldly talk and gossip and all that. Many times he would not even entertain Vedantic discussions. Gurudev writes in one place that when he would like to discuss about Vedant, Taponji Maharaj would not entertain that. He would say, go and meditate, enough of your discussions. Go, sit quietly, contemplate. And one place he told Gurudev also that in his advanced stages, he told Gurudev that, why are you going to the forest to meditate? Why do you need peace to contemplate? Contemplate where you are. Right amidst all the disturbances, contemplate. So such a great master as Vak Tapas. Then coming to the third one, is the Manasik Tapas. So he says, Manaprasada Saumyatvam. What is Manaprasada? One who is very peaceful. Saumya, very very cheerful. Always the mind lived in, that mind was in the state of calmness. Saj means to settle down, sit. Prasada means the mind is very settled, not agitated, not disturbed. In the Gita it is said, Prasade sarva dukkhanam hani rasyopajayate. Prasanna chetaso hyashu buddhi paryavatishtate. That a cheerful mind, when it is there, then the buddhi also settles down. And only such a person can steadily contemplate and know the truth. How will you attain that prasada buddhi? How will you attain that state of prasada or peace? Through prasada buddhi, through karma yoga. And we see in the life of Taponji Maharaj a beautiful combination of karma, upasana and jnana, all of them. 34 years he lived his life in complete karma yoga. He was an editor of a magazine also. He did without many many articles. Many things he did to follow his duty in the world. So he did karma yoga. He did upasana regularly. And whatever happened, he never forgot that this is by the grace of the Lord. His whole life he lived like that. Manaprasada. Saumyatvam. Very cheerful, very peaceful. Sthairyam, very steady. The mind never wavers. In fact, his life is an expression of sthairyam. Right from childhood, he steadily entertained the thoughts of renunciation, asceticism, tapas, and he lived like that. Not a moment did he think that maybe, you know, the world has some more pleasure. Maybe I missed something. No wavering, no wandering, no indecision. Very steady. Once a resolve is taken, just keeps going. So many obstacles came on his way also. But steady. Sthairyam. Because the mind has so much of vivek and vairagya. Again and again in Ishwar Darshan, these two things we come across. And he keeps saying that the mind will be tempted. And the only way to handle that is constantly bring the thoughts of discrimination and dispassion. Constantly. One cannot expect that suddenly the mind will become steady and then it will never fall back. Because of the past tendencies, there will be so many ups and downs which will come. The only way is keep on bringing the thoughts of discrimination and strengthen the vivek again and again and again. And in his case, he says that because of the maybe innumerable merits of the past lives, that his mind was steady in dispassion, discrimination and dispassion, and in the thoughts of the Lord. That he constantly entertained the thoughts of the Lord in his mind. So sthairyam. Atma vinigraha. He had complete control on his mind. Atma vinigraha. Single pointedness is another meaning of this Atma vinigraha. When the mind is very single pointed. One incident in Taponji Maharaj's life is what single pointedness that he expected from his students. And he said that one morning when he was taking the class, and there was a crow which made a sound, and one student looked up there. He said, "Vedant class is over. I can't teach such inattentive students." Just imagine what single-pointedness of the mind. Why? Because Vedant says that if you listen to this knowledge with complete single-pointedness, realization is here and now. So he would expect that. And he would also live like that. Complete single-pointed attention to whatever he did. So maunam atma vinigraha. Bhava samshuddhi. Purity of mind. What to talk about the purity of mind? Just looking at a bird, looking at the wind blowing through the trees, he would get into trance. And if you read the introduction of Gurudev, Swami Chinmayananji, in The Wandering of the Himalayas, Gurudev writes that when I used to travel with my master, I would feel I am so immature. Said, looking at this nature, why is he going into trance? So that the purity of the mind, which saw everything as expression of Brahman, as divine. So bhava samshuddhi, very pure in his mind. And because of that purity of the mind, his intuition was also very, very strong. Many times he would not exhibit his intuitive powers, but some places he did. So it is said in one place, in Badrinath, where he used to stay, so he had a group of learned people with whom he would have satsang. So there was one person called Swami Krishnamacharya, with whom he would have satsang, and very learned person. He had a desire to go for Kailash Yatra. And intuitively Swami Tapanji Maharaj knew that this is not good for him. But how to stop him? How can you tell him that don't go for Kailash Yatra? So Tapanji Maharaj writes there that it was not possible for me to give him any worldly reason, and even a reason as grave as death, to stop him from going for Kailash Yatra. Because he himself has braved all this and gone to Kailash Yatra. But intuitively he knew. But he could not tell that to him. And so he went. And he said that very soon, after a few days, he got the news that this person passed away because some robbers, some bandits attacked him, and in that he got killed. Once it is said that from Gangotri, generally he would leave at a certain time every year when it becomes cold, and he would come down to Uttarkashi. He said once it happened that he left unusually 15 days before that. And people wondered that why is Tapan Maharaj leaving so early? Why did he leave 15 days before? And the next 3-4 days, a huge flood came into the Gangaji and the entire Kutia was swept away. So many such things happened in his life where his intuition was very, very strong. Sometimes it is said that he was waiting for Gurudev. Some people say that no, that was not true. Some people say that it is true. But it is said that he was, once he was not beginning the class, and they asked him that, "Swamiji, why are you not beginning the class?" He said, "My disciple is yet to come." And at that time, maybe after a few moments, that Gurudev came to meet him. So that way his purity of mind was, I mean, one should not even say that he had pure mind. Gurudev used to say that pure mind is Brahman itself. If mind becomes totally pure, is Brahman. So we speak about purity of mind. What is our definition of purity of mind? As the Upanishad would say that a mind which is pure is mind which is not bound to any sense objects. Bandhaya Vishaya Satta Muktam Nirvishayam Smritam. The mind which is not bound to any sense objects is a mind which is pure. And And so our mind which has some attachment, we have to put effort to get free from that attachment and cultivate purity of mind. For him there was no such need to cultivate purity of mind. He was purity itself. So manaprasara saumyatvam sthairyam atmavinigraha bhavasum shuddhiritya tapo manasamuchyate. So this was his tapas. Physical, at the level of speech, at the level of the mind. Intellectually also he did a lot of tapas, constantly tuning up, contemplating only on Brahman. It is said that once when Gurudev came here, in the beginning, he saw one sadhu standing in the Ganges. From morning till afternoon, facing the sun and doing the upasana of Surya Devta. So when Gurudev looked at him, he said, you know, he came to Taponji Maharaj and he said, I can't do this kind of tapas. So Taponji Maharaj said that you are wondering that you can't do that kind of a tapas. Go and ask him. He is wondering that he can't do this kind of tapas that you are doing of constant contemplation on the self. In Journey of the Master it is said that the same incident is described in a different way there. It is said that Taponji Maharaj asked him, told him, go and ask him that what are you doing this tapas for? So in the afternoon when that sadhu came out, not a sadhu, that person came out, they asked him, Gurudev asked him that what are you doing this tapas for? He said, you know, in my village there is a girl and she says that she will marry only the person who is a serpent. So I am praying to Surya Devata to make me the serpent of this village so that I will marry that girl. And imagine looking at him, Gurudev thought that he can't do this kind of tapas. So he wanted to go away. So the very definition of tapas is that intellectual constant contemplation on the truth. So these are various aspects of Taponji Maharaj's life where he lived as a great tapaswin. And as a sannyasi, it is said that who is ready to be a sannyasi? In the Gita there are three qualities which are given. That when the mind is not disturbed by any sense pleasure, yadahi na indriyartheshu, no sense object can tempt that person. Na karmasu anushajjate, there is no restlessness to work at all. And sarva sankalpa sannyasi, a person has no fanciful imagination of happiness in something outside. Such a person is ready to take sannyas. And Taponji Maharaj, you see all the three, no temptation of any sense object. No restlessness to work, no restlessness to even do seva. It is said that once he was even offered, it is said that Swami Paramanandaji, who was the head of Kailasa Ashram and Brahmananda Ashram at that time in Rishikesh, he asked him that why don't you become the head of this Brahmananda Ashram, you become a Mahant. Because a person like you endowed with such dispassion and such rare qualities is very important and you would set a nice example. So why don't you please become the Mahant? The position of a Mahant is a very great position to be offered. And Taponji Maharaj very politely declined to him, saying that my bent of mind is such that I don't have any interest in any type of administrative work. I want to do only constant contemplation and revel in the glory of God. So no restlessness to do even karma yoga, to do even seva, nothing. And that mind is so clear. You know, it is said in the Gita, action when it is done in the right spirit can liberate us. And action when it is dropped at the right time can liberate. And Taponji Maharaj did both. For 34 years he lived in his life as a karma yogi, did the action with the right spirit, offering it to the Lord, no desire for rewards, nothing. And when he dropped karma, he just dropped at the right time, never to take it up again. So even though he was offered, he never took up. So no restlessness to work, no temptation of the senses, nothing, no imagination of pleasure, And that's why he took sannyas by himself. And later on, when people persuaded him that why don't you take sannyas in the scriptural way from a particular guru, so that the tradition is not broken. He did not need that, but still he respected that thought. And so it is said that from Swami Janardhan Giri of Kailash Ashram, he took sannyas, and his name was, he was given the name as Swami Tapovanam. So he was a very great sannyasi. What are the qualities of a sannyasi? No likes and dislikes, no sense of doership. These are two main qualities. Gaun sannyas is where dhyaya sanitya sannyasi yona dveshti na kangshati. He does not have raga and dvesha. But mukhya sannyas is navadvare pure dehi naiva kurvan na karayan. That a person lives in the body of nine, in the city of nine gates, but lives with that attitude that I am neither the doer nor do I cause anything to happen. So with that sense of absolute freedom from doership, one lives. And the life of Taponji Maharaj was like that, that he had no sense of doership absolutely. And how he lived, that he was very embodiment, he was a very adoration to the word sannyas. It is said that how he exited his body, Swami Sundarananji says that when he was very ill and last few days, so many Mahatmas came there to meet him, to see him, and to see how does a Jivan Mukta leave the body. So they said that many of them came and they were right there in the veranda of the Taponji Maharaj's kutya. And they used to stay there only. They didn't want to miss seeing this, how does a divine Jivan Mukta leave the body. So they said that day, early morning, Taponji Maharaj got up at 3 o'clock and Sundarananji brought the coffee to him. Many of the Mahatmas who have come to see a Jivan Mukta depart, they have not even woken up that time. They thought that, you know, wake up at 4 o'clock. But Taponji Maharaj got up at 3 o'clock that day, drank 2 sips of coffee, gave it to Sundarananji, and he said, Ishwar ko dhanyavad ho, ab main chalta hoon. Gone. Consciously exited the body. So what is written in the Gita, in the 8th chapter, that how you can exit the body consciously, Taponji Maharaj did that. So focusing your prana here and chanting Om, and then prana ejects. So he exited the body consciously. He did not want any name, fame, popularity, nothing. So even the time of his exiting, so many Mahatmas, they came all the way to see that. He went silently. Ishwar ko dhanyavad ho, ab main chalta hoon. No attachment to anything. I was just thinking the other day that how it must have been for Gurudev. Gurudev was doing a yajna. When he got the news that Taponji Maharaj took samadhi, and how he must have felt. Because he came, he would now and then in between the yajnas, he would come, meet Taponji Maharaj because he was not well, he would spend some time, and even at that time Taponji Maharaj would tell him that, Chinmaya, it is very easy to preach Vedanta, but it is very difficult to live. And Gurudev would have tears in his eyes. Who will not have? Naturally, for the Guru you have so much of gratitude. It is not that moha is there, but the gratitude is there, and you see the Guru in that state, you feel so sad. And even there Taponji Maharaj would teach. And his very famous incident was, he told Gurudev that, imagine somebody who has come to meet you, and you are very busy, and you have no time to meet him. What will you do when you finish all your work? Will you not take the first opportunity and meet that person? For 68 years, Lord Death has been waiting for me. Now that I have finished everything, why should I not meet him? Imagine listening to all this from your own guru. And then Taponji Maharaj left the body. No attachment to anyone, anything. He didn't even think that my disciple Chinmaya is the best disciple, my favorite disciple, he will come here, then in front of him I will have nothing. He just left. Absolutely dispassionate, he lived his whole life. He did not even entertain correspondence from his own house. Yet his compassion was so deep. When he took sannyas, he made somebody make a painting of his as a sannyasi. And he sent that with a note to his house to inform his brother. His brother's name was Shankar. To inform his brother, he sent that picture. And in the note what he wrote what it is to be a sannyasi, how blessed it is to be a sannyasi, and how the family should rejoice that somebody from their family has become a sannyasi and has not, and they should not grieve. And that whole thing he wrote and he sent it to the house. Till then, for 17 years after he left the house, his people in the house had no clue where he was. And after 17 years, finally when they found out where he is and they wrote to him that, you know, we would like to know about your health and happiness, so can we communicate with you? He said, you can communicate with me if you have any spiritual counsel to seek. I have no time for any worldly communication. No attachment to anybody, anything. And so when he departed also, he departed like that. So he actually came as a sannyasi only he came. He lived as a sannyasi and he departed as a sannyasi. In between he took the formal sannyas twice. That is only of what you say. It's like a formality. So to that great master and his lineage is where we come under. So we invoke the grace of Taponji Maharaj that may even a small amsha of his tapas, his vairagya, his gyan seep into us, and may we live befitting to the great glory that they have given to sannyas. Right. I just want to end with this nice description of Swami Shivananji about Taponji Maharaj. He says that he is verily tapovanam, but not wild vanam or jungle grown with rough growth of dry austerity and cynical seclusion. He is rather an upavanam, full of fragrance of the flowering of Vedanta and filled with the fruits of his mature realization. It is an upavanam where countless bees in the form of seekers, sadhaks and sannyasis crowd to drink of the honey of true wisdom. Simultaneously with his great Vedantic experience, he is yet mellow with parabhakti. He is a bhakta jnani. What Swami Shivananji writes about Taponji Maharaj, that is not just a dry tapovanam, but is a upavanam. Right. So when we have come here to Taponji's abode, and we take bath in the Gangaji, the tradition is whenever we come to such a yatra, we should take up one tapas and we should drop one negativity. That is what transforms us. So if you think it appropriate, before you leave the place, take up one tapas that you will follow the whole life, and one negativity which one can drop, saying that I have come here in my tapas, I drop this negativity, and may Gangaji's grace be with us. See, many negativities we may not be able to overcome by our own effort, but when we come to places like this and we invoke the grace of Taponji Maharaj, of Gangaji, of the Himalayas, of the whole Guru Parampara, We get that strength to overcome that negativity, purify ourselves, move closer to the realization of the truth. So let us do that and live the life of tapas. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnaat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.